Thank you all so much for coming tonight, and thank you to the Strand for having us. It's such a pleasure for me to be able to do an event with Elijah, who's been, his writing on the blues in particular was such a huge influence and inspiration for me while I was working on my book, which is called Do Not Sell at Any Price, and is about obsessive collectors of rare pre-war recordings, specifically on 78 RPM discs. So I could read a little bit from okay, maybe it'd be better if I did that up there. I like this, what we're doing here. So I'm gonna read a little bit for maybe 10 minutes or so from my book, and then I'll ask Elijah if he will entertain me.
Yeah, then I'll entertain for a little while.
A few questions, and then you'll read and maybe play some music, and
I'll just come up after you, and then we can do a thing after.
All right, perfect.
I will. I promise. I know. I'll turn it on. So far, I'm not, you know. So far, they're getting the behind-the-scenes chit-chat.
So tonight I'm going to read a little from Do Not Sell at Any Price, which, as I said, is about collectors of really rare 78 RPM records. So for those of you that are maybe a little bit less familiar with the format, 78s are kind of the earliest iteration of what we think of as a record today. They were the 10-inch shellac discs that were introduced around the turn of the century, mostly phased out by the 1960s. And they contain about 2 to 3 minutes of music per side. Unlike vinyl records, they're extraordinarily fragile. Shellac is quite brittle. If you drop it on the floor, it will shatter. And because of that, and because no surviving metal masters remain for most of these recordings, they are extraordinarily collectible and trade amongst collectors of this music for crazy sums of money. And my book looks a little bit at the sort of oddball subculture of the men who lionize this format, and also do the kind of hard work of preserving this music that would otherwise very likely be lost. So I'm going to read a little bit about a trip that I took with a collector named Chris King to a flea market in Hillsville, Virginia, which is in southwestern Virginia. Chris had had luck there in the past finding some very rare records. And by a rare record, I mean a record of which there's maybe one or two or three extant copies in the world. And he had become very interested in a rare record vendor named Roger Hicks, who often had a table set up at this flea market. And I kind of pestered him into letting me tag along while he went there to try to buy some records. So I'm going to read a little bit from that chapter about Chris and I and our time in Virginia. And we'll say a couple days before I left New York for Virginia to meet up with him, I asked him, you know, if there was anything in particular I needed to pack for the journey, and he sent me back an email that said, you know, a water bottle, a backpack, a pair of comfortable shoes. It was a sort of long list of things, and the last thing on the list, I'll never forget, said, a disbelief in what humanity can bear. So with that having said, I will read a little bit about the Hillsville flea market. This is from a chapter sort of towards the front of the book called This Is One of the Things I Would Say Is Inexplicable. King and I approached Hillsville from the north, rolling through miles of bucolic countryside, up and down smoothly like a surfer straddling his board at sunrise. Abundance was in the air. Just a few miles outside of town, the yard sales started, driveways and porches crammed with junk. Out-of-towners were coming with cash in pursuit of they ain't saying what. And anyone lucky enough to own property along the primary artery to the market was taking full advantage of the sudden influx, luring shoppers off course with renegade wares. Entire houses appeared to have been turned inside out. Traffic slowed. There was some aggressive browsing. People were caffeinated. King, for his part, was stoic, unswayed by the siren call of unregulated product, and by 8:40 a.m. we had parked at a lot in town, $5 to the man in the overalls, and were marching briskly toward Roger Hicks's tent, past the vendors with fanny packs of small bills, past the women tearing open packages of gas station donuts and unleashing tiny puffs of powdered sugar. The air was airless, heavy and close, like a wet sheet. Tramping through a flea market with Chris King is oddly thrilling, like getting tied to the back of a heat-seeking missile or being RoboCop. As we moved steadily toward our target, King scanned various tables and booths, pointing out any vendor with a gramophone. To King, the most obvious signifier of a potential shellac windfall. I can't overstate how good he is at this. He can turn a corner and point out a Victrola in about 1.5 seconds. I, meanwhile, was distracted by nearly everything, and for each whiskey decanter that I paused to admire, King discovered another sagging box of old media tucked inside a teak mid-century buffet. At this point, he was only making mental notes of spots to revisit. We needed to get to Hicks by 9 a.m., when the flea market officially opened and vendors could begin selling their goods. By the time we found Hicks's booth, there were already a few shoppers milling about, including a collector King recognized, a soft-spoken older gentleman with a mustache and a buttoned-up shirt named Gene Anderson. After I introduced myself, Anderson let me flip through his want lists, which he'd slipped into clear plastic pages and assembled in a binder. Based on the contents, he had what appeared to be a solid collection of pre-war country and blues records on his shelves already. King, meanwhile, nodded hello to Hicks, a middle-aged man with thin brown hair pulled into a ponytail and a pair of tiny oval-shaped sunglasses, leaned over a box of 78s and began thumbing away. On a piece of cardboard, someone had written, "Good 78s, be careful." But rivulets of dew had already dripped through the tarp Hicks had strung up, saturating the sign. King snorted and pushed it aside. Most of the tent was filled with used rock LPs, 45s, and CDs. Roger Hicks seemed to have some passing sense that certain old 78s were worth something, although he also hadn't really bothered to follow that thread to any logical pricing conclusions. The bulk of his 78s were marked at just a couple bucks, although a few in especially good condition were randomly priced at $100 to $300. Some negotiation was expected. King chatted amicably with Anderson and kept on pulling out records. I stood a few feet away, jotting impressions of the crowd in my notebook, like woman in visor holding an LP and yelling, "Jim, look, Steve Miller," and occasionally peeking over King's shoulder. I felt acutely aware of wanting to stay out of his way, lest I complicate a delicate acquisition process. At some point, King faux casually asked Anderson what he'd picked up so far, then appeared relieved when Anderson showed him his selections. Watching two collectors interrogate each other about recent, or in this case, ongoing purchases is a little like watching two high-achieving middle school students warily prod each other about a grade. "What'd you get?" "What? What'd you get?" Finally, Anderson paid for his records and ambled off, and King showed me the 78s he'd pulled, which included two notable rarities. Eddie Head and His Family's Down on Me, Lord, I'm the True Vine, one of two, maybe three known copies. It was priced at $2. And Sylvester Weaver's Guitar Blues, Guitar Rag, less rare but in notable condition, an E copy which would replace King's E minus copy. After a bit of gentle bargaining, King paid Hicks $100 cash for a total of 9 78s. He knelt down in the grass and gently tucked the records into his case. He was pleased. I picked up a few of King's cast-offs, including 78s from Stick McGee, Washboard Sam, and Blind Boy Fuller, and a stack of Victor pressings of early Carter Family tunes. I paid around $40 for all of it. I was beaming. King was proud. In retrospect, it occurs to me that if one was interested in compiling the world's most comprehensive collection of sweat-soaked t-shirts, the Hillsville VFW Flea Market and Gun Show would be an unqualified mecca. Here, the gradual darkening of pre-shrunk cotton mirrors a darkening of the soul. It is unconscionably hot and crowded, and attendees are forced to contend with several miles of gently used detritus. All the bits and bobs, 1,000 riffs on colored plastic, humans have designed to ease our long, slow crawl toward death. Surrender is required, or else you will crumple under the weight. When a portly man sporting strained cargo shorts and an orange "Guns Save Lives" sticker unleashed an epic undulating belch a couple inches from my face, we were both digging somewhat frantically through a mound of state-shaped refrigerator magnets, I found myself not only not repulsed, but almost wanting to shake his hand. Hillsville allows for, and perhaps even encourages, sudden reinvention, and you could probably outfit an entire one-bedroom apartment here for $500. There's copious bounty to be ravaged. Hand-carved Victorian bed frames and kitschy atomic age knickknacks and gold and ivory pocket knives are plentiful, but so are dented IKEA nightstands and used Cabbage Patch dolls and Duracell batteries of unknown origin. It is a feast of accumulation, presented without judgment or categorization. I was instantly reminded of Donovan Hahn's A Romance of Rust, Nostalgia, Progress, and the Meaning of Tools, a 2005 Harper's essay in which the author visits the barn of an antique tool collector and is struck by how zoological his collection appears. Divorced from usefulness and subjected to morphological classification, they looked like the fossils of Cenozoic mollusks or the wrist bones of tyrannosaurs, Hahn wrote of his subjects' prizes. There is no sense of genus or species at Hillsville. Everything is everything. But product, detached from both its intended use and the codified retail experience, becomes ungrounded, ill-defined, and increasingly absurd. All parts and no corresponding whole. After less than an hour of browsing, the merchandise at Hillsville resembled a word I'd said too much, as if I'd accidentally subtracted all meaning via blind repetition, as if it had never had any meaning at all. Particularly upsetting were objects of recent vintage. Piles of video games from 2011, hardcover installments of Harry Potter, an unopened Cuisinart Panini press. Hahn, at an estate auction, remarked how an inkjet printer, still in its original box, had already passed into that limbo of worthlessness that exists between novelty and nostalgia. And looking across the field, I recognized that vast and endless void, the terrain of the freshly outmoded, of that which is neither useful nor evocative. Obviously, none of this slowed us down. Existential duress has no place at Hillsville. It is softened or eradicated by the consumption of deep-fried foodstuffs. Near the gun section of the market, an old VFW hall overloaded with every kind of assault weapon imaginable, some in shades of pink for the lady in your life, a scrum of hunters in tank tops were selling taxidermy and assorted sundries, dustpans, bathroom scales, plastic nativity figures from the back of a pickup truck. I paused to admire a white-tailed deer head mounted on a slab of oak, a steel at $20, and scratched it behind its ears until King gave me a look that said, "Don't do that." Later, he did nod approvingly when I purchased an old puzzle, copyrighted in 1981 and called Feelings. It consisted of 5 wooden cutouts of a young girl in varying throes of emotion: sad, afraid, angry, happy, and love. And required users to match her face with a corresponding title. Still, as I was paying, he couldn't resist saying, "That would be so much better if it had been made in 1975. We also looked for 78s, in Victrola cabinets, under piles of John Denver LPs, wrapped in sheets of yellowed newspaper, in the back seats of vendors' cars, shoved under tables, in blue Tupperware bins labeled old records, stacked indiscriminately in the high bleeding sun. But despite several hours of thorough digging, little else of note emerged from the fields. So goes junking. The Eddie Head and Sylvester Weaver records were enough to make the trip worthwhile. We began hiking the 5,000 miles back to King's car. I had started to register several unsettling smells. Of particular impact was the aroma set free each time someone stumbled out of a porta-john, freeing its cooked contents, that vile steam, into the air. I experienced an overwhelming urge to both wash my hands and to dry heave. My hair had mostly loosed itself from its bun and was sticking to the sides of my face in new and interesting ways. The Volkswagen, when we arrived, felt like a life raft. Thank you, guys.
You left out the punchline, which is that not quite at that flea market was in fact one of the rarest goddamn finds of the last decade. I should mention, by the way, that the way we first got to know each other was me writing her a fan email after reading this book. I love this book. So I'm really thrilled that you came. Thank you.
Pleasure. Thank you.
I'm not going to read from my book. I don't do that. Not for any particular reason, I just don't do that. The one I did was when I did Van Ronk's book, because I loved reading that man's prose, and I, for those of you who haven't read Dave Van Ronk's book, The Mayor of MacDougall Street, I was involved in bringing it into the world, but it is that man's prose, and boy, that man's prose is good. What I'm going to do right now is take advantage of the fact that you are live and captive in front of me and play you a bunch of music that I wish one could put in a book, but you can't put the music in a book. All you can do is write the book and you try to say what things sound like, but you can't because they sound like that and you can't explain that, but now I can do it. Of course, we now live in an age when you can find a lot of this on Spotify, but not all of it. We have some rare records. Actually, you can find this one on YouTube. This is the earliest Bob Dylan in existence, from when he was, I think, 16 years old. This is, if you've heard that Bob Dylan started out trying to sound like Little Richard. Nope, that's not the right track, is it? We want this one. Yeah, yeah, yeah. Right. So that's Bob Dylan, age 16. And I'm going to just run through a bit of history, because the way the history is normally told is that he did that in high school, and then he discovered folk music and showed up in New York sounding like Woody Guthrie, and for his first record he was being a traditional folk singer. And one of the really fun things about this project was, one of the fun things about any project is discovering how much you have completely misunderstood and need to completely revise your thinking about. And one of the moments for this one was talking to Peter Stampfel, who some of you undoubtedly know his work, and some of you may actually know Peter, of the Holy Modal Rounders and the Fugs, who he and Jim Queskin and Dylan actually worked a bit as a trio, something I dearly wish I could have heard. But he says that he first heard Dylan when Dylan had been in New York about 4 or 5 months, and it changed his life, because he had always loved R&B music and he'd always loved hillbilly music, but he thought of these as two completely different tastes, loved by different people and incommensurate. And he said, the first time I saw Dylan, he was singing hillbilly songs like they were rock and roll, and I realized that my two tastes were in fact one taste. And when he said that, my first reaction was, I don't know what you're talking about. I don't hear that in Dylan. But then I went back to the first album and hit this, which is on the first album. I'd heard it a million times, had never noticed that the guitar part is Wake Up Little Susie. So goddamn it, he was right. And when I heard that, I thought, oh my God, I've made a discovery. You know, that first album, which we all thought was Woody Guthrie, in fact, he's in it. Then I read the liner notes. It says, Highway 51, guitar part reminiscent of the Everly Brothers. The liner notes also credit Carl Perkins and early Elvis Presley as his influences. And that became sort of one of the core things that I realized I had completely misunderstood about early Dylan, because that was who Dylan was in fact sold as and loved as, was as a sort of rock-influenced young guy who was coming in playing folk music with rock energy, and specifically playing blues. That first New York Times interview that's all, review that's often spoken of, when people say when he was singing like Woody Guthrie, never compares him to Woody Guthrie. It compares him to Blind Lemon Jefferson. Again, something I had never noticed. And The next thing that happened after that first album was that Columbia Records released his first single, and his first single sounded like this.
I got mixed up confusion.
1962.
Man, it's a killing me. There's too many people, and they're all too hard to please.
So remember, this is the period before Dylan has gone electric, right? This is even the period before anyone has heard of Bob Dylan, and that's sort of the story. That nobody heard that first record virtually. I mean, I suspect, I'm guessing virtually everyone in this room has that first record, and I'm guessing virtually everyone in this room, it was not the first Dylan record you bought. That you had another Dylan record, and then you went back and bought his first album. Because most of us didn't discover him through his first album. Most of us discovered him through this record. So, Dylan first arrived in Newport in 1963 as the guy who had written Peter, Paul, and Mary's number one hit. And that's who he was to the people at Newport. He wasn't an exciting, young, rock-influenced blues singer. He was the guy who wrote the pretty song that Peter, Paul, and Mary did. And they finished the first evening of that first major Newport Folk Festival with Bob Dylan on stage, backed by Peter, Paul, and Mary, Joan Baez, Pete Seeger, and the Freedom Singers, a civil rights quartet up from Albany, Georgia, with Bernice Johnson Reagan, for those of you who know her, in it, and her husband, Cordell Reagan. All of them backing him on singing Blowing in the Wind, and then joined by Theodore Bickel, who we just sadly lost last week, leading the whole crowd in We Shall Overcome. And to understand the story of Dylan at Newport, you have to start by understanding that for a lot of people at Newport, that's who Dylan was. He was the guy who, joined by those people, led everybody in singing Blowing in the Wind and We Shall Overcome, and had written an anthem of the civil rights struggle. So 2 years later, he's on stage, and instead of doing that, so I want to chat with Amanda, but I'm going to play you two other snippets first, because I just want to say a little bit more about Newport and about that night. First of all, there are a lot, I mean, Dylan, yes, in answer to the question nobody has asked, but someone surely is wondering, he was booed. There were a lot more people cheering than booing. One of the reasons some of the people booing were so upset was all of the people cheering. Newport had been kind of overrun that year by pop fans there to hear Bob Dylan, who didn't give a good goddamn about the folk festival. And there was already a lot of resentment about them before Dylan ever stepped on stage. But there's also the fact that it was a hard year. I mean, I called this book, the subtitle is The Night That Split the Sixties, and I'm not saying Dylan himself split the Sixties. 65 is a year that really, what we call the Sixties kind of begins in 64, 65. I mean, you look at Martin Luther King's March on Washington, which Baez and Dylan played at in 1963, and it's a protest march and everyone is in suits and ties. The same weekend that Dylan went electric at Newport was the weekend that Lyndon Johnson doubled the draft and firmly committed the United States to victory in Vietnam. It was a moment when the previous summer had been Freedom Summer, when a lot of young people from up north went down south to help with the voter registration drives organized by SNCC, the Student Nonviolent Coordinating Committee. In 65, SNCC, led by Stokely Carmichael, was kicking out its white membership. A lot of people at Newport felt like their world was fragmenting and was hoping that Dylan was going to hold everything together for them, and instead he was shouting, "How does it feel to be on your own?" For many of them, how it felt was horrible. And I'm saying those things because a lot of people act, the way it's often written up is he was playing an electric guitar at Newport where they hated electric music and they hated rock and roll. So I just want to say, the first night at Newport that year, Dylan played Sunday. Thursday night, this was the biggest, the most popular group that played Thursday night.
Well, you know I got it.
That's the Chambers Brothers, and you can say, yeah, well, that's gospel music, but they followed it with Little Walter's Upside Your Head, and then their version of Summertime. It was a very varied set, and when they finished, Alan Lomax, the most purist of purists, jumped on stage and said, "I am so proud that the Newport Folk Festival has finally presented America's true modern folk music, rock and roll." That was the purest position. The purest position is Chuck Berry and the Cadillacs and the Drifters are true folk music. At least the Alan Lomax had tried to present the Cadillacs at Carnegie Hall. They didn't show up in 1959. He had presented Muddy Waters Electric and a female doo-wop group from Detroit because he felt people in New York needed to understand that real folk music in New York was black kids singing doo-wop, not white kids playing hillbilly banjos and pretending that they came from down south. That was the Lomax position, and I want to play just one other tiny track because that same night we also had Joan Baez and Donovan, and then Baez did her own set in which she produced one of the only three, I guess, responses in that whole festival to the fact that the Vietnam War was escalating. This was her statement on that.
Dedication to President Johnson on his marvelous foreign policy. Stop in the name of love.
So that's how much the folkies hated pop music. And before I sit down, the one last thing I want to say is I pulled that off. I stole that. But all of the tapes of all of the Newport Folk Festivals from 1963 through 66 are now in the Library of Congress. Your tax dollars have made them available to anyone who wants to hear them. All you have to do is walk in, say what afternoon or evening you want to hear, and you can hear any of it. And it is amazing. I mean, the famous set where Alan Lomax gave a nasty introduction to the Paul Butterfield Blues Band and ended up in a fist fight with Albert Grossman, a story that I tell in the book, also included Alan Lomax having what I, as he made the introduction, thought was a crazy and stupid idea. He had Mance Lipscomb and Son House on stage, and he said, "Why don't you guys play something together?" And God damn it, they did. And
Sunhouse just did his thing, which is all Sunhouse could do, and Mance Lipscomb created this bass part around it that is brilliant. I was thinking, you know, one of them's from Texas, one of them's a Delta blues player, they're not gonna be, yeah. Anyway, let's chat.
Well, my first question, obviously, is where can I get one of those amazing shirts?
I make them.
Elijah goes electric.
I make them and is this thing on? Are you hearing me? It's all good. I make them and I never learned how to fit anyone else. I learned how to fit me by trial and error. So it's all like, I just make shirts for myself.
Well, one of the things I really wanted to ask you, and I appreciate you entertaining these questions for me tonight as a fan, one of the things I've always admired about your writing on music in particular is how kind of clear-headed and generous you are about certain American myths. I mean, the myths we perpetuate and why we perpetuate them. And when you write about those things, and you did this certainly in Escaping the Delta, which is Elijah's book about Robert Johnson, you know, it's not so much about debunking the myth as it is about sort of questioning why it endures, you know, the myth itself and why we keep repeating it. So I'm curious what draws you to those particular fissures sort of between the way maybe something objectively happened and the way that we end up talking about it.
It's funny, I don't think of myself as being drawn particularly towards that, but I mean, the obvious answer is my own ignorance. The obvious answer is, you know, I come in to write about something for any number of reasons. I mean, Robert Johnson, I came into because it suddenly hit me that of all the grand iconic figures in American music, here was one who had only recorded, 21 different songs? And so you actually could talk in depth about every single song he had recorded. And you can't do that about any other major figure. And so that's really how that started. This one honestly started because I realized that if I could get out this book in time for the 50th anniversary, it would probably pay my rent for a couple of years. But then the next step is you go in thinking you know what you're gonna hear. And in my case, virtually always, you go in and you find that that isn't what you hear, not because other people got it wrong, but because you're you and they're them. I mean, you know, if you go to Barcelona, I don't care how many things you've heard about Barcelona. If you walk into a bakery and someone is nice to you, it's a great town, and if they're mean to you, it poisons the visit. And so, you know, it just sort of, you end up with your own take on things. The one other thing I'd say, though, is this: when I did a book called "How the Beatles Destroyed Rock and Roll," which started with the title. I loved the title, but it wasn't actually against the Beatles. The point was complicated, but basically was all revolutions destroy what has preceded them, and much as you may love the revolutions, they all have that effect, and what had preceded them was a world of live dance bands playing rock and roll, which after the Beatles, anyone who went dancing to records, and records classified as soul records or R&B or disco by the time I was in high school, and nobody danced to rock anymore. But anyway, in that book, I started thinking about the fact that music history, art history in general, I think tends to be done really, really badly as history because it gets mixed up with criticism. And I would say history and criticism are not just different, they are absolutely opposed. Because the point of criticism is to say whether something is good or bad and why. Which is necessarily a statement about how it holds up in the present. Whereas the historian's job is to understand how people felt about things in the past, which is absolutely the opposite of that. And I, after a while, started using the smart aleck remark, if we did political history the way we do music history, we'd write the history of the 20th century and leave Hitler out because we didn't like his work.
It's true. You have that great quote in the book from Charles Seeger, Pete Seeger's father, where he's talking about the truth is like a rabbit in the briar patch. Like, you don't know exactly where it is, but it's in there somewhere. And I feel like that probably is germane to many of the histories and the stories we tell about art, especially.
You know, one thing coming out of this book, I need to read more Charles Seeger. I have two quotes in there from him, both of which I love. There's that one, and there's also a great quote where he says, you know, everybody really tends to like to listen to the music of their social stratum. And they'll listen to the music of another social stratum now and then, but they don't want to hear too much of it. And he was talking about the folk revival, and, you know, the fact that basically, you know, what middle-class kids want from folk music is the Kingston Trio and Peter, Paul, and Mary, middle-class white kids. They don't want Almeda Riddle. You know, they'll be interested in it.
Mm-hmm. Absolutely. You tell this other great story in the book about John Cohen of the New Lost City Ramblers having a conversation with Dylan at one of the after parties at the Newport Folk Festival, and Dylan seeming sort of genuinely bewildered by the reaction that he received to his performance. And I mean, obviously, he's a famously inscrutable figure, but in the course of researching and writing the book, did you get a sense of, you know, to what extent he knew precisely what he was doing there, and to what extent it was a perhaps fortunate accident?
Fortunate or unfortunate?
Right.
No, I think without... Incidentally, I should say, I really tried to not to even vaguely attempt to psychologize Dylan in this book. I mean, I've read so many people trying to do that, and it's... I mean, come on. But no, clearly he had no idea what he was walking into, because how could he? The whole thing was a complete chance occurrence. He had not gone to Newport planning to go electric. He had showed up with his acoustic guitar. It happened that the Butterfield Band was playing there. It happened that Mike Bloomfield, who had not been playing with them regularly, was there playing with them and was the guitarist on Like a Rolling Stone. It happened that Al Cooper, who had played organ on Like a Rolling Stone, was there just because he liked going to the Newport Folk Festival. The record had just been released. When Dylan played Saturday afternoon, the afternoon before, with his acoustic guitar, a huge portion of the crowd was yelling for Like a Rolling Stone. It was definitely the big request he was getting. And he pulled together a band and played his new hit. I'm not saying it was quite as simple as that. Peter Yarrow says that Dylan was pissed off because he had been put partway through the first half rather than closing the night, and considered that to be a diss. To be fair, the closing act every night at the Newport Folk Festival led a sing-along, as Dylan had done back in 63. And, you know, so they had Baez leading O Freedom, or Odetta leading We Shall Overcome, or Pete Seeger leading This Land Is Your Land. And Dylan didn't do that by 64 or 65, so he couldn't close. But no, I don't think he expected to get booed. No one had ever booed Dylan in recent years. I mean, yeah, back when he was a kid. And Peter Yarrow to this day believes, and I think he's probably right, that if Dylan had come out and sung Mr. Tambourine Man acoustically, and then said, now I'd like you to hear, you know, I've got some friends together and I'd like you to hear what I'm doing now, that everybody would have completely accepted it. Which is the other part of the story. I mean, we've ever since that night been used to the Dylan who walks on stage, barely smiles, never says a word to us, sings his songs and gets the hell off. But that night at Newport was the first time he ever did that. He had always been perky and funny and smiley and kidding with the audience, and you know, he'd been everybody's pal. And, you know, there was a lot of stuff going on.
I can imagine. Well, I want to save some time maybe to get some questions from folks in the audience. But I was curious, I mean, there's a whole kind of canon of literature about Bob Dylan. So how did you contend with that as part of your process? I mean, how much did you read? Did you just ignore everything? Did you read everything?
No, I have to say, I thought that the Dylan part of this project was going to be easy. Because, God damn it, how could there be anything more to say about Bob Dylan? I mean, really, I walked into this project thinking, I only had the idea to do this in February of 2014. So my agent, who is here, can tell you. I mean, I was walking down the street,
it suddenly occurred to me that it was a year and a half from this week, and I called her up and said, if I could write a book on Dylan going electric in Newport in 6 months, do you think you could sell that? And she had sort of been, I mean, my last book was on the tradition of the dozens, black African-American mother insulting. This is not an agent's dream project. This one was the call she wanted to be getting. And she said, yes. And I thought, great, because this one will be easy. Because, you know, all the Dylan stuff has been done. Mm-hmm. So I just read the books and compile it, whatever. And then I started hitting things like, Wake Up Little Susie on the first album. And no, he wasn't sounding like Woody Guthrie, goddammit. And I started listening to all the early tapes and realizing the only two Woody Guthrie songs on the Minneapolis tapes are the two you could learn off Odetta records. And that the whole thing was just different. Mm-hmm. Like I said, I mean, when you go over stuff yourself, it always looks different. Mm-hmm. So the other thing I realized was everybody writes about Dylan as a writer. Mm-hmm. And I don't disagree with him. I mean, that unquestionably was his greatest contribution, but it's not why he went electric. He didn't go electric because he was a poet. He went electric because he was a musician. And Dylan the musician doesn't tend to get written about. Mm-hmm. And I'm a folk blues guitarist, so also I was listening to all the freewheeling outtakes, and God damn it, he was playing great. He was gonna do a second blues album, there are all these takes in the can for what would have been his second blues album, and then he wrote Blowing in the Wind, and Albert Grossman said, no, we're going that way. And they scrapped all of that and went that way. But yeah, so all this other stuff turned up. And the other thing was I then got into the whole Pete Seeger thing, which, you know, I suddenly realized nobody... You know, like the stuff you wrote about in your book, I mean, records have become the way we understand the music of the past. Mm-hmm. And records will not help you understand Pete Seeger because it's not on records. I mean, what Pete Seeger did, he did live. If you listen to the records, I don't care. Even, you know, he did some decent records, but why Pete Seeger was the giant of the folk scene, you cannot explain by listening to his records. You had to be in the room with him, but everybody had been. That's how the folk scene had been constructed. And so that was another thing that just became... Just this realization that I had to explain who Pete Seeger was in 1959 or 1960 for Dylan and everybody else, because particularly the Dylan Goes Electric story has always been told by rock fans. And for them, who Pete Seeger was that guy who... the camp counselor who made us sing Michael Row the Boat Ashore at summer camp liked so much. Mm-hmm. As opposed to Little Richard, who we liked so much. Mm-hmm. And so they were all ready to frame the Dylan at Newport thing as old fuddy-duddy meets exciting rock and roller, which just profoundly misstates who Seeger was. Mm-hmm.
He's such a beautiful and complicated presence in the book. I mean, the book is as much about Dylan and the folk festival as it is about Pete Seeger.
Yeah, no, I mean, one of the points I was trying to make is, like, the way the story is often told is Pete Seeger is simple and Dylan is complicated. And God damn it, if there was ever anybody more complicated than Pete Seeger, I can't imagine who they were. I mean, one of the most complex and interesting and, in a way, difficult figures in American music. And, I mean, he's been turned into the summer camp thing. And, it's really important to remember that Dylan's idea of Pete Seeger was the guy who's facing 10 years in prison for contempt of Congress for standing up to HUAC. I mean, the first quote we ever have from Dylan on Pete Seeger is from 1961 when Seeger was going into court saying they're trying to frame him, they're railroading him. I mean, you know, complete Jesse James kind of a pretty boy Floyd picture. And that's who Pete Seeger was to Dylan. No, it's a complicated, it's fun.
Mm-hmm. No, absolutely. Did he pass away while you were reporting the book?
Seeger had already died when I started working on the book.
Mm. All right, well, should we take some questions? Yeah, hey.
And from the back of the room, Eli Smith, the
hello.
Single most, I'm given to hyperbole, but he is the single most important figure in the revival of old time and folk and blues music in New York. This is the producer of the Brooklyn Folk Festival, the Washington Square Folk Festival, the leader of the Downhill Strugglers. This guy is it.
But there was a lot of anger about Bob Dylan going electric, which did manifest. And would you say that it started at Newport or not? And how does that relate to Pete Seeger and whatever he represents and what I mean?
I have to say, by and large, I think anger is the wrong word. I think what people felt was disappointment. Everyone I've talked to, the way they describe what they felt was disappointment, and the feeling of the people who felt disappointed, you have to understand in the context of what folk music was and what rock and roll was before that moment, which essentially was, on the one hand, the music the intelligent kids who ran the literary magazine and were college-bound listened to, and on the other hand, the dumb music that the punk kids who just liked to get drunk and party and dance listened to. And even kids who liked rock and roll, one of the fascinating stuff reading stuff from the late 50s and early 60s is even kids who loved rock and roll assumed that they would grow to have other tastes when they went off to college. Dylan was a perfect example. He was the Little Richard kid who, when he went to college, got into Odetta and Leon Bibb and Harry Belafonte and eventually Woody Guthrie. But that was an absolutely typical trajectory. You might get into jazz, you might get into early music, but you weren't going to keep liking rock and roll once you grew up. No grown-up liked rock and roll. And when the Beatles hit, it didn't really change that. I mean, the Beatles were still going, "She Loves You, Yeah, 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 and I Wanna Hold Your Hand," and the people screaming were teenagers. And when Dylan first went electric, I mean, George Wein has phrased it perfectly. You know, he says, you know, for a lot of people, when the Beatles hit, it was really hurting the pop folk scene. I mean, the whole Peter, Paul, and Mary world was going over toward the Beatles. But the people who really felt like they were the smart kids were listening to Dylan and Baez and reading Steinbeck and caring about the civil rights movement and were not going to go, "I Wanna Hold Your Hand." And when Dylan went that way, for a lot of them, the first reaction was disappointment. That essentially he was going and the guy they thought was their friend was going and being friends with the popular kids. And their next reaction was, "Wait a minute, we can have fun too." And I mean, George Wein looks at it, he says, you know, after Dylan went electric, they could join their friends. And they didn't have to be, you know, sort of the losers. And from then on, he says, you know, "We did the festival for another 4 years, but after that, we were just folk singers. We weren't it anymore. We weren't where it was happening." That was a long answer to a short question.
No, it was a good one.
Yes. Sorry, I guess you have to get the microphone.
Elijah.
Yes.
When Dylan kicks off Maggie's Farm.
Yes.
Who says, "Let's go"?
Michael Bloomfield.
Perfect.
I should mention, by the way, it's very rare that you get to write about an incident that has not only been completely 100% captured on tape, including the pauses, the coughs, and the yells from the audience, but also on film. This was not a hard one to research, and it's really, really funny. I have to say this, I just got an email yesterday from Al Cooper saying that he read the New York Times review and he has to tell me that everything I'm saying is a bald-faced lie, and he gave me the list of all the things I'm saying that are lies. And I wrote back and said, "Al, you know, the tapes are available. I mean, the stuff you're listing, this is, you know, there's stuff we can argue about, but not whether Dylan closed the night. He didn't.
On Sunday, and so I'm only at about page 150, but I noticed that you lay your thesis out very clearly about page 3, and use that term that Dylan, the alternative narrative, as opposed to him being the trailblazer and all of that, was that he, and I think I'm paraphrasing it pretty closely, he walled himself off he shut himself off behind a wall of electric noise, is the term that you use. And I was just curious, how would that be different from, say, what Muddy Waters had done, you know, over a decade before, Howlin' Wolf, as opposed to Petey Wheatstraw or Robert Johnson and all of that? How is what Dylan did different from that? And then the second thing, very quickly, is I was very intrigued by your idea that the
communalism of Pete Seeger.
Thank you. I'm sorry. The communalism of Pete Seeger.
Or grew up with the radio and that individualism. I thought that was a really interesting idea that you pursued.
As for the first question, let me phrase this as nastily as possible. Muddy Waters and Howling Wolf were a couple of savages beating their jungle drums and howling in their incomprehensible African dialect, and that was their job. Whereas Dylan was a poet and you were supposed to understand and listen to the words. I'm overstating that, but the that was how the music was, I think, largely understood by the fan base that was listening to both things, was that they were the roots that would then be mined by intelligent people like Bob Dylan and Paul Butterfield and turned into something modern. I mean, I'm phrasing it as nastily as possible, and clearly the Rolling Stones and any number of people highly respected Muddy Waters and Howling Wolf also as human beings, but that certainly is a big part of it. I mean, in fact, part of the pleasure of Howling Wolf was not being able to understand the words. I'm serious. I mean, like Charlie Patton, you know, his incomprehensibility is part of, I think, what attracts a certain kind of listener to it.
Yeah, absolutely.
Anybody else?
There we go.
Hello. Okay, so the first question is about the political sphere, and I know it's a little bit outside of the whether you see parallels between what was happening at that time and now in terms of certainly racial violence, expanding war, etc. And so whether you see those political parallels, and if you have anything to say
about the role that music plays today versus
then in the movements, in various movements, in various struggles, etc.
Sure. First of all, I should say the role of the music in the politics of that time is very much not outside the scope of the book. I mean, I don't draw an analogy to the present, but I mean, that's very much part of what I'm talking about, and part of what I do try to sort of underline in the book is that it was a moment where, particularly for people at Newport, political music was hugely important, but the most hugely important political music was not Bob Dylan and Phil Oakes, who in that world were in a sense lightweights. It was the freedom songs. I mean, at Newport, it was the fact that there really was a movement being held together by music down south and generating its own music. And a huge part of what Newport was supposed to do was bring those people up north so you could actually meet them. And there's this wonderful introduction Pete Seeger gave in 63 to the Freedom Singers, saying these are people who have been jailed multiple times, who don't, you know, the point is they don't just sing this stuff on stages.
they're out there in the world doing this, and if you want to be part of this, go down there and join them doing this. And that had been Seeger's dream in the 30s and 40s for a singing labor movement, but the labor movement had no interest. I mean, one of the complete misunderstandings is that the Communist Party wanted folk music. The Communist Party had no interest in folk music. I mean, Pete always talked about a communist functionary saying, you know, if you want to organize the workers of New York through music, take up clarinet. They wanted Duke Ellington. They didn't want the Almanac Singers. With good reason. But goddammit, in the 60s, it really happened. I have to say, my impression of what has happened since then has been that people have tended to take the Dylan and Phil Oakes model and run with it, and I think it's profoundly wrongheaded and stupid. When I go to a rally in January and hear five dull speeches, and then a musician comes on and gives me another dull speech, only they're strumming an electric guitar and it's rhymed, it seems profoundly not what that should be for. I would like to see movement music that interrupted the speeches by getting everybody up on their feet, singing and dancing and getting involved, not having to listen to another person displaying their ego the way the speakers are doing. And I haven't been hearing that. But I hope that means I'm just going to the wrong places. Incidentally, my wife just yelled, and she's absolutely right. What we have seen that I would say is closest to movement music, and what blows my mind, it's wonderful, is the fact that now protest marches suddenly tend to have brass bands. And the brass bands are much, to me, closer to the freedom songs and to the movement music that really functionally served as movement music in that time. Then the singers trying to sing politically conscious lyrics, who cares? My wife incidentally plays in a honk band and, you know, has... Rude Mechanical Orchestra in New York, but I mean all over the country now, and that is great because it does exactly what music's supposed to do. It gets people up and involved and moving together.
Thank you.
Yeah. Hi there. So I always heard Maggie's Farm as a criticism of the folk movement. So when he gets up on stage here and starts off his set with that, isn't that sort of a provocation to that crowd?
I don't think so. I mean, honestly, as with the people who think, you know, and then he follows with It's All Over Now, Baby Blue, which is really a kiss off to the folk scene. I can't find one person who heard it that way. Everybody heard It's All Over Now, Baby Blue as he's come out with his acoustic guitar and is singing one of the songs we like instead of the nasty electric stuff. I mean, the people who didn't like the electric stuff. And Maggie's Farm... I mean, Solomon Burke had just done a cover of Maggie's Farm as a civil rights song. I do think this story has kept being told by the rock and roll kids as a sort of proverb or whatever about, you know, the stupid, uncomprehending folkies not understanding that the times were changing. And I'm not saying that's entirely wrong, but I don't think that's what Dylan was doing. I'm sure there are people who heard it that way. Yeah, sure. Certainly Pete Seeger profoundly didn't... I mean, he said he didn't understand Maggie's Farm. But his comment was he thought it was trivial. A very odd adjective to apply to that song.
I'll do one more question.
So I haven't got to the end of your book yet. I'll start, but I'm wondering how much you go beyond Newport. I'm thinking particularly the British tour with the Hawks and the famous Judas moment and so on. Bringing up the Peter Yarrow theory that if Dylan had coaxed everyone along at Newport, it might not have become this great schism moment. I'm wondering if that the reportage of the moment radiated and thus helped be created.
Yeah, I think that people who heard about Dylan being booed, a lot of people felt like the way to keep the spirit of Newport alive is to boo Dylan from now on when he comes out with his electric band. Absolutely. In answer to the beginning of that question, I don't go much beyond that. I mean, I do go into the repercussions of that night, but I'm not particularly Dylan-centric about that. I mean, the big repercussion, you know, the next big thing that happened was Barry Maguire doing Eve of Destruction. You know, was all the Dylanoid stuff that started happening. And let's not forget the Rolling Stones, who simply spent the summer doing Dylan imitations. I mean, Satisfaction, 19th Nervous Breakdown, Get Off My Cloud. And it's not me who phrased it that way. There's a wonderful quote from Mick Jagger that I have in the book saying that, yeah, Dylan came up to Keith, said, you know, I could have written Satisfaction, but you couldn't have written Mr. Tambourine Man. And the interviewer says, well, what do you think he meant by that? I mean, it wasn't a put-down, was it? And Jagger says, well, yes, of course. But, I mean, he's like that, and... I mean, it's funny, it's true. I had one other thought, but I don't remember what it was. So I want to thank Amanda so much for...
Thank you. This was great.
So when your next book comes out, do I get to do this with you?
Yes.
Okay, cool.
Yes, I hope so.
Thank you all very much for coming. We're not running anywhere. We're supposed to sign books now, right?
Yeah, if you guys want to stick around and sign some books, we'll play some tunes and socialize a little bit. On behalf of the Strand, I want to thank both of you very much. We want to give a little hand to Elijah and Amanda. And thank you guys for coming out. Have a good night.